Tucked away in the hills of one of California's most beautiful regions is one of racing's truly great venues, Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca. For more than half a century, race fans have come to Monterey to see sports cars battle the elevation changes, sweeping corners, and of course, the corkscrew. And today will be no different in the second race of a doubleheader for the IMSA WeatherTech SportsCar Championship. 8 of the best manufacturers in the world will dance around this beautiful circuit for 2 hours. Who will emerge victorious in this West Coast swing? Find out right now on Fox Sports. Welcome to a breezily beautiful Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca for part two of the Continental Tires Grand Prix at Monterey, powered by Mazda. Hi, everybody. Delighted to be back with you. Greg Creamer along with Calvin Fish. And folks, earlier this afternoon, the prototype and GT Le Mans classes ran in their own race. But now we focus on our two Pro-Am divisions for their standalone two-hour race. And in Prototype Challenge, it was only a couple of weeks ago, they ran at Long Beach. But Cal, this track is very, very different than that one. And with this format, they have a rare opportunity.
They really do, Greg. For the PC cars, they're typically part of the four-class WeatherTech Championship races. But today, a shot at an overall win. And the glory and the exposure that it brings should be an awesome race. Some really quality drivers out there that will have a chance to shine here today in California.
And for GT Daytona, a very different story. It's been a long 6 weeks since they last raced at Sebring. Cal, when you take a look at how qualifying unfolded with 6 of the 7 manufacturers in this class represented in the top 7. Clearly, these teams and drivers are anxious.
Oh, they are just chomping at the bit to go racing against their first sprint race of the year. So it's not only the strength of your finishing driver, but the quality and speed of your full season driver pairing will play its part today. So the heart of their season really begins right now.
Well, Cal, you mentioned the key word for both classes. It's been an eventful and entertaining start to that season. In Prototype Challenge, 2016 began with a rough start for the defending champs. For the second year in a row, Core Autosport failed to complete the Rolex 24 after an engine failure 6 hours in. That opened the door for the 85 of JDC Miller Motorsports to grab their first Prototype Challenge win and take home a Rolex.
In Sebring, the champs were back and dominated the 12-hour event, starting on pole and taking the number 54 to victory lane for the second time at Sebring. Long Beach found Daytona winners JDC Miller Motorsports back on the top step for their second PC victory after leading all but 4 laps in an impressive Long Beach debut.
2016 in GT Daytona has brought new rules and great racing. The series updated cars to the global FIA GT3 spec and showed them off at Daytona. In the end, the tight battle came down to fuel mileage, with the 44 Audi of Magnus Racing holding on for the win on fumes.
Scuderia Corsa debuted their new Ferrari 488 in Sebring and dominated the event, taking the pole and the victory home for Ferrari. And Christina Nielsen became the first woman to take a class win in Sebring since Liz Halliday did it in 2006.
That was a look back, and when we come back, we'll hear from the other two members of our broadcast team, Brian Till and Justin Bell, on the grid.
California dreams. California dreams.
It is an absolutely beautiful day at Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca. WeatherTech sports car action coming your way. You know, in motorsports, fortunes can turn on a dime, and we've seen that. You go back to last year, champions in the Prototype Challenge class, Core Autosport, John Bennett, Colin Brown, you had everything your way. This year has already seems to be one to forget. A blown engine at Daytona, you win at Sebring, but then contact in the last round at Long Beach, and now the car is starting from pit road. I understand you got sick crew members with food poisoning and everything else. Man, what do you got need to do to change your luck?
Yeah, I don't know. It's definitely been a tough year for us at Core Autosport, but we're a tough bunch of guys. We had a bit of a fuel probe problem this morning on the Core Autosport car, so had to miss the recon laps, change that out, start from pit lane. We'll have a drive-through penalty to serve right away and be a lap down, probably starting this thing out. So certainly a bit on the back foot, but man, it's gonna be a fun race and exciting to hopefully come through the field.
And they'll use that strategy to try to get to the front. That's Prototype Challenge. For more on GT Daytona, none other than Justin Bell.
Well, down here on the grid with Christina Nielsen. Christina was winner at the Sebring 12 Hours, and you're on the front row of the grid here. What a run for you.
Yeah, it felt absolutely amazing to win the 12 Hours of Sebring. We had five podiums last year, but no victory. So to finally take that victory in the WeatherTech Championship feels absolutely amazing.
And of course, Ferrari's in every category very competitive this weekend. Mid-engine may suit the track, you think?
Yeah, you know, I think Scuderia Corsa and the new GT3 and GT2 488 has been our product to beat. It's definitely a bit of a machine on the track, and you know, it's proven it's good for long distance. We did well at the 12 hours. It's been good on pace. It qualified on pole in GTLM, and we got second here in GTD. So it's been wonderful to drive.
She's got to jump back in the car, guys. So she's starting the race. Back to you.
Thanks, Justin. And her lap in qualifying was a beautiful one, beautiful enough to match the surroundings here in Monterey. When we come back, it's green flag time, so don't go anywhere. Welcome back to the Continental Tire Monterey Grand Prix, powered by Mazda. You know, Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca is a much-loved track, Kelsall. Why don't you take us around it with our Ford track map?
Well, this is a special circuit, Greg, so let's take a closer look. Just under 2.25 miles in length, 11 turns, about 26 gear changes per lap. Very smooth, relatively low grip. Key to speed here is momentum. Good overtaking opportunities into turn 2 and into turn 11. Very important corner is turn 6. You must get through there cleanly for a good run up the right hole straightaway to the infamous corkscrew, and then that big plunge over the hill to rainy curve. It just doesn't get any better. It's a magical place.
And now let's take a look at our WeatherTech weather update. And like the track, the weather is pretty magical right now. Mid-70s, the humidity's dropped by 30% from what we had earlier today. The wind has picked up just a little bit, though. With that sand and gravel around the track, that can always keep things interesting. And now we're going to show you our Continental Tire starting grid. That'll be across the top of the screen, as always. You can take a look at that. Here now are the WeatherTech keys to victory. And Cal, it starts with, get a grip, dude.
Well, the track grip here fluctuates. You talk about the sand blown across the race circuit. Certainly the conditions will change over the course of these 2 hours here this afternoon. So the key is make no mistakes. Maximize your minimums. The drive time is 40 minutes minimum for the Pro-Am drivers. You're going to make sure you execute that. Then pit stops, one or two. Well, we saw the GTLM class victory go to a one stop this afternoon for Ford. Maybe someone can do the same today.
And we've got another development as well. We heard Brian Till talking to Colin Brown that the 54 car will start through pit lane. The points leaders in the GT Daytona category class are as well, Cal. They had apparently a fire in the warm-up.
Yeah, some kind of issue with the fuel probe, and suddenly you can see there's some smoke down there in pit lane. They had to do a clean-up late to the grid. There's a cutoff time that you have to be set to be on the pre-grid. They missed that, so they'll start from pit lane. And then there's also another rule that kind of adds to the problem, is that you have to then do a drive-through, because sometimes in the past when people are on fuel, they'll start from pit lane, so they do a couple of less reconnaissance laps, so they make you come through the pits as well. It's a big blow to these teams.
Well, and when you're talking about how tight those windows are for a two-hour race,
right,
you know, that's a huge advantage if you can play that card, so they've eliminated that. And as you can see, lights are out in the pace car, so we are looking forward to going racing this time by. Big story there in the poll, really, in the number 52 professional security consultants car. That is from PR1 Matheson Motorsports. Robert Alon, who has come up through the Prototype Lights Championship in the lot, getting his first pole in this category of racing. Pretty big story.
It really is. It was a sensational lap that he put together here yesterday, but a lot of pressure on this 25-year-old driver. Going to be driving with Tom Kimbersmith here this afternoon. He has the experience. Three Le Mans class victories for his co-driver. There's going to be some really quality guys finishing off this PC race here this afternoon.
As you can see, they are lined up just beautifully here. Bit of a gap back to the GTD class cars, so we will follow this one out of the last turn. Alon leading them around beautifully, watching for the green flag. Here it goes, and here he goes. Boy, did he read that to perfection. What a launch by Alon.
That was just perfect. Just took the lead, grabbed it by both hands, and he takes the pressure off down into the brake zone. Look at this. Three wide there down into the Andretti hairpin. Alon's wide. He's scrambling there for grip a little bit.
He found it. It's the number 8, slots into second. Oh, and you see the number 20 entry. That's the bar 1, top 1 oil car. And just running a little wide on the exit, lost a couple of spots.
He did. He's trying to regroup there a little bit. Tire temps aren't up as we now get ready for the GTD start.
and bringing him to the line. And the number 23, Team Seattle Porsche, is Alex Ribeiras. And I'll tell you what, Christina Nielsen, she read that absolutely beautifully. He was able to go along with Ribeiras. Can she make it work around the outside in the Ferrari?
Look at this, down to the inside. That's Brandon Davis in the AMG Aston Martin.
Nope, wasn't able to make that through, so Christina hangs on to second, Davis third. And I'll tell you, the guys in that Audi, in that four spot, that's Andrew Davis, starting for Stevenson in the number six car, have to be pretty pleased. They were struggling with some directional changing, a bit of a push in the car. They've got it dialed in. We hopped on board for just a moment. One of our camera cars, Ben Keating, in that big Viper.
Yeah, this class is sensational. My mistake, the TRG Aston Martin, of course, not AMG. That's a different brand. Getting excited here at the off, but fantastic field here as we see these guys scrambling for grip, coming out of turn five in that run to turn six. This is a key corner here, the run up to the corkscrew.
Boy, and just look at this field of cars. It's, as we talked about, seven manufacturers in this. We want to look there by the 16 from Change Racing, one of the Lamborghini Huracans, not able to do anything. It's going to be interesting to watch here. Patrick Lindsay from the back of the field. We kind of figured they did a tire change, moved to the back. He was really quick in qualifying with the third, but a huge spin, Cal. Smart move, maybe, to get fresh tires.
It really did. He probably flat-spotted more than one tire. Big move there down into the brake zone for turn 11. Is that Lamborghini? I think it's Corey Lewis going for a spot right there.
Corey's got a lot of track knowledge because he's been doing triple duty here this weekend. Ooh, one of the BMWs, Marcel, out wide. But Corey Lewis, he ran earlier today in the Super Trofeo race in the Change Racing Lamborghini.
Yeah, and he went from the back of the field all the way to the front, so a brilliant victory for him. Marcelo, 2014 winner here in GTD competition with Dane Cameron for the Turner Motorsports team. On board now with Cooper McNeil. They've been really struggling with brake issues throughout practice and qualifying. They believe they're on top of it now. The sister car, of course, started from the pole and leads.
And up front, yep, there it is. Ribeiras easing away a little bit. Then Christina, then the blue Aston Martin. The rest of the field, and again, Lindsay taking a look at 33 Keating as they come through five.
Yeah, he could be the big mover in the early parts of this race. Four fresh Continental tires, he's gonna be going for it to make up for this little mistake that happened right here. He got wide through turn six, spun the car around. They had to change the tires for the start of this race.
Yeah, a lot of times when something happens in six, it's big, and he got away with one, didn't contact anything, but as you said, clearly damaged the tires. Nielsen down the hill in the Scuderia Corsa Ferrari. Solid second right now.
She's just been doing a great job over the past couple of years. Ran with Kevin Buckler's group TRG last year. So close to a championship, as she said to JB. Five podiums, no wins, but they've certainly ticked that box early in the season with that brilliant victory at Sebring.
You have to, I think, keep an eye out for the car running in third right now. It's that 007 Aston Martin that you were alluding to. I mean, there's a heck of a driver lineup in that. Brandon Davis starting and James Davison finishing.
Two really quick guys, and a lot of it comes down to the strength of that driver pairing, as I said, in terms of how this championship will shape up. You have to have a pro-am driver. All of the drivers are given a specific grading dependent on their results and their experience, and you're supposed to have a pro-am guy, which means he's not really earning his living from driving race cars. He has another profession. But there's kind of these gray areas, Greg, where people get graded silver that you have to be, and they're really pros in some stretch of the wording.
Well, there's some serious lobbying that goes
yes.
on, I think. And you can appeal, you can say to the ACO and the FIA and go, well, we're not really sure that that's accurate. By the way, as we watch the Aston Martin work through, if you're wondering where's the second of those yellow Turner BMWs, it's here. It's just not yellow anymore. They've got a new partner on board. And AFE Power, and they are sporting a new graphics package on the car. So it's here.
And it looks awesome.
Yeah, does it? There it is. Just popping into view there. A couple of cars back. There
he is. Andrew Davis had a good start here. He's up to the fourth position. He and his teammate Rob Nadell won the Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge race. There you see him just behind Brandon Davis coming into view right there into the hairpin. And there's that BMW. It looks good in yellow and blue. I really like this scheme, though, on the 96.
Yeah, they're very excited about that. Brett Curtis behind the wheel in the early going. And he's going to be turning it over to a young man who's very quick, Jens Klingman. So as you said, I mean, we've got some very good drivers in the first part of the race. And in the second part of the race, it's basically a pro field.
Oh, there's some factory drivers out. There's a BMW factory driver in the 96. You got Bergmeister, a Porsche factory driver in the 73. This is going to be a shootout at the end, Brian.
And talking to the guys at Turner Motorsport about those BMWs, the 96 and the 97, what they told me was they didn't really feel like they had a good handle on the car in the beginning, but they took Brett Curtis to the streets of Willow, which is at Willow Springs Raceway out here in California, right after the last round, and let him run and run and run. You can go off the racetrack, you can spin, there's really nothing to hit there. He said they really found a lot of confidence in that car, found some setup information. Brett Curtis feels like he knows it so much better right now, and he's putting it to good use. They found the balance. They think this racetrack's gonna be good for that big old BMW M6.
Seat time.
Yeah, that's what it's all about. And Brian said it, big old BMW M6 is a beautiful looking car, but it's so much longer, about a foot longer in wheelbase and in the overhangs. It's a, talk about the GTLM machine, similar guys at Long Beach. They said it was really a struggle to get through the streets of Long Beach here, but GTD didn't run there, so. But it's certainly very competitive. It's shown a lot of pace in the early part of this season.
And right behind him is that green Lamborghini Huracan of Corey Lewis, the number 16. Behind him is the number 48, the Paul Miller Group.
They've been struggling a bit this weekend.
Oh, yeah, they have.
Had some diff issues on Friday, which caused a lot of understeer in the car and really scratching their head, but they're digging deep and coming back strong.
Well, one of the things with those cars is, you know, the engines make power, but they're not torquey. We've kind of talked about that before, so you really need to roll mid-quarter speed. And if you got a push, which they've been dealing with, a lot of the cars have in that, it just kills it, doesn't it?
It really kills your speed around this racetrack. You're just waiting to get back to power, and you're losing a tenth on each corner, and suddenly you're over a second off the pace. But I think Madison Snow and Brian Sellers are going to be one of the very strong driver combos for this year. Definitely a championship threat. And remember, Paul Miller Racing come up just one position shy in the championship for 2 years in a row.
And up to the front, it is again. A solid run here and already catching some lap traffic. Things are changing at the front. We'll be right back to cover it for you. Stay with us. Beautiful views of a beautiful facility here at Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca for the Continental Tire Monterey Grand Prix, powered by Mazda, down into turn number 11 as you're taking a look at the GT Daytona field and that car that's leading that group that we've kind of been watching there of Andrew Davis. I think they found something, Cal, because after not being on pace, they were second in that morning warm-up and ran quicker than they qualified.
Yeah, and that's always a nice sign for a team. If you've been struggling with your speed all weekend long, you have that warm-up session just to tune on it a little bit more, and they found some pace somewhere.
They did, and of course, one of the big stories here, we mentioned it, the points leaders from the Magnus Racing Audi team, having to start from pit lane due to some problems. And I think we've got Mr. Lally down in the pit lane, Brian.
Andy Lally standing here with the radio, talking to John Potter in the car right now. And I talked at the very beginning of the show about how fortunes change very quickly in this sport. You win, then you have another podium at Sebring. Small issue here, how do you get back to the front? How do you hold on to the points?
Well, we got our work cut out for us today. Yeah, it's a little bit ironic that we have a fuel fire when we have a solar power sponsor here this morning. I got to say thanks to Oryx Solar for being on board. It's the same normal Magnus attitude. You know, we're going to fight all the way to the end. And these guys have been killing it in a short amount of time that they had to clean up a fire from pit lane right after warm-up and get us back out there. And John's on the lead lap right now. That's all we really care about right now. We got to stay in front of that Porsche because that thing's going pretty quick.
Any concerns about the repairs that were done? Obviously, fires are always an issue because you end up with these electrical gremlins.
You always wonder if some wire burned 95% of the way through and it's just ready to finish itself off here. But I've got all the faith in the world in my guys. They looked over everything as quick as they could. I wouldn't want anybody else working on the car.
There you go. They're focusing forward down at Magnus, guys.
Boy, and speaking of focusing right now, John Bennett is in the race of his life right now. He is at the end of that lead lap because I'm sure he had to do that drive-through penalty you talked about, Cal, and he's got James French attacking, and he needs to stay in that lead lap too, doesn't he?
He really has to really give his teammate Colin Brown a chance at clawing his way back into this mix, and you can see him right there. He's dealing with the GTD traffic. Look to his right side. You can see the leader right now, James French, trying to be careful, but at the same time, he would love to clear John Bennett and put him a lap down. Look at this, side by side in a turn four. That's McMurray, I think, making a move on Goikberg.
Well, you've got to take advantage of those opportunities when those little windows open up.
Is that Popov? No, that's Popov, I think. He's up to the third spot. Goikberg looks to the left. He gets stymied a little bit. McMurray there in the tail end of that battle. He's looking for a way through. a young 18-year-old American.
This is the first time he's been in a prototype car since racing with Shank and Petit. So he's getting used to things.
Yeah, he's running the GTD races for the Enduros with Park Place and then running the remainder of the season in a prototype challenge car.
And you'll notice there is a second Viper in the field, but it's not one of the white ones we're used to seeing from Riley. That is Dan Knox with his Lone Star Racing team. And
there's a dive plane went flying there. Goikberg really struggling to clear this traffic.
This is fierce.
Oh, did he get touched there? McMurray looks to the inside. This is wild stuff.
So it settles just a little bit. And as I was about to say, Mike Skeen, nice to have him back in the paddock in racing as he's teamed with Dan Knox. Only four races they're planning to do at this stage. And of course, we also want to update our defending class champions. That would be Bill Sweetler, who's out there right now in the number 11 Lamborghini. Townsend Bell is with Justin Bell.
Yeah, we're brothers with different mothers, right? Different accents, too. Hey, TV, it's a big month for you, May 1st. And at the end of the month, you do the big one for you, the Indy 500 again, but this time with probably the car that could put you at the top.
Yeah, we've got a great team with Andretti. I'm thrilled to be with Honda again. And it's my favorite time of year. I mean, listen, we're in Laguna Seca. It doesn't get much better than this. And then I go to Indy. Then I get to go to Le Mans. So I'm in hog heaven right now. But we're rooting Bill Sweetler on, my teammate. He's out there in the Robert Graham Lamborghini giving everything he can. And we're going to use every ounce of performance out of the Continentals right now. It's hot. Everybody's going to start sliding around more and more as the stint goes on.
So this track is a little slick in the Lamborghini, you said. But hopefully, if you manage the tires, it's the last sprint you're holding on for.
Yeah, that's kind of what we set up for, is to really try to take care of the back end of the car so that at the end of the stint, when it really is going to count, hopefully we're strong and consistent and other guys fall off.
Do you know what? For any young racing drivers out there, look at Townsend Bell as a business model. It really sucks to be Townsend Bell, just throwing that out there.
He paid all the bills, didn't he? He hit everyone in that interview. Nicely done, TB.
And you see here, Bennett was not able to stay on that lead lap. French has gone through, but I'm not so sure that's the worst thing in the world if he can stay now with French. I mean, he was feeling huge pressure, and if he can just stay with French, reference him a little bit, maybe that'll make it a little bit easier for him.
Yeah, it really is. It really depends on yellows. Do you know what I mean? Ideally, they need him to stay with him, then get Colin Brown in and get back on the lead lap. If they get a yellow, suddenly he is a lap down and stuck that he's not going to get a wave by. That's really the key issue.
Boy, he sure was giving it everything, though, trying to stay put. Here's the number 540, another of the GTD, GT3 Porsches. This one from Tim Pappas' group. Pappas behind the wheel.
They had an awesome start to the year at Daytona. Great run there on the podium. Beautiful car. Tim Pappas' team with Nicky Katzberg this year, one of the fastest GT drivers literally in the world at the moment. The first guy to really step up and commit to this Porsche program along with Alex Job. It's two different teams, but they both made the commitment early.
I think Tim really missed doing the endurance races. He got out of it for a little bit. And he had a lot of success running in the GTC class and the American Le Mans Series, a couple of championships.
Yeah, he's a really solid performer and loves his racing. Total commitment. Saw the talent in Nicky Katzberg last year in different championships and signed him up.
Oh boy, and for Bennett, it gets tough again in his mirrors now. Rejuvenated Robert Alon in the number 52 right there. Then pop off Goikberg and McMurray. That is your top five in prototype challenge or PC. It's still Ribiris over Nielsen. And there is Alex Ribiris. And big news for him here this weekend, Cal. He's just been named to actually be the second driver in the car. And Ian James will be now moving into the endurance driver role.
Yeah, I spoke to Ian James a couple of months about this decision. He said, I'm having a hard time really making that call because he was signed up to do the full year. But he said, I really believe in Alex's talents. He said he's got a wonderful career ahead of him. I'd love to give him that opportunity. And he said, I may step aside. It was really Ian's decision. No one forced him into that. So, kudos to Ian. He will still do the Enduros. He'll be at Watkins Glen. He'll be at Petit as the third driver. But he's very much the backbone of this team, along with Don Kitch and the whole Team Seattle group.
Well, one thing anybody who has met him knows about Ian James is he's a class act. So proving it once again. So as Ribiris is proving that Ian was right in terms of his talent, we're going to step away for just a moment. Nielsen and Davis round out the potential podium.
There's always so much to see and do here at the IMSA WeatherTech races, and Corvettes certainly know how to deliver on the entertainment. But we always want more, don't we? So here's your chance. You can register to win a 2016 Corvette Stingray Coupe, a limited edition IMSA signed Paul Reed Smith guitar, and a trip to the 2017 Rolex 24 at Daytona. Here's how you do it. Go to www.racetowincorvette.com, and the big prize might be yours.
The number 38 from Performance Tech continues to lead after having got around pole sitter Robert Alon and has stretched that margin out, James French has, to some 6 seconds. This was one of the few venues last year where he didn't irritate the heck out of Chris Cumming in qualifying, and Cumming was able to hang on to it, but French right now, he's flying.
Yeah, I mean, he's really dynamite in qualifying. He's one of those guys who just continually sneaks up on it. And almost got the pole here yesterday. He's had 3 poles last year. Actually had a pole position slot at Long Beach, then the session was cut short, so it didn't become official, but really has a lot of speed, really maturing nicely.
That he is, and here's a look at, again, at our GT Daytona leader, and it is Alex Ribeiras. But we talked about the story that seven of the manufacturers were represented almost in the top seven. Well, 6 of them are in the top 6 right now. I mean, it is really, really intense here in GT Daytona in terms of the parity that we're seeing here, which really speaks volumes about that GT3 spec package.
It does, and particularly when you're introducing turbo cars like the 488 that Christina Nielsen drives and the BMW M6 from Turner Motorsports. So it's quite a task to get all of these cars performing at a similar level, particularly when you go to different racetracks week in, week out, different configurations, different pros and cons in terms of where the strengths and weaknesses are of the car. But to have 6 different marks in the top 6 really is a testimony to that.
I mean, Christina wanted to wait and let that number 8 of Popov go through when she was ready and not affect her flow too much. She's having a solid run, as we said, qualified second, sit second right now, and second in the points, lots of seconds right now, but they have to be pleased with that. And then here comes Brandon Davis in that TRG Aston Martin Racing 007.
Saw this team run at Daytona, then very rare missed appearance at Sebring to regroup a little bit, and they showed a lot of pace here. And we talk about the driver pairings, as you said, one of the strongest in the field.
And Calvin, you know, it's amazing down here on the grid before the start of the race, you're watching dads and mums with their sons and daughters, and it's definitely these big GT cars that captures the imagination, and the Viper is still one of the fan favorites, and it just signifies everything that's great about American muscle. You know, it's a car that defied logic, and definitely almost defies logic the way it goes around this racetrack. And talking with Kevin a bit earlier, he was just saying, you know, it's definitely going to be a handful round here, but we know the track well. We know how to manage these kind of races. We're setting it up for the last half of the race. And I meant Aston Martin. That is my brain going to another place. I'm standing in front of the wrong pit. But it applies to both, let me say, Aston Martin or Viper. But the Aston Martin, it's one of those cars that absolutely captures the imagination, and these guys know how to run it. And seeing it out here, it is such a fan favorite. Everyone loves it. But as you know, Calvin, we always joke about Kevin and how enthusiastic he is. Well, that's why his cars run so well. He's got a passion for this sport. He's got great drivers in there, and he's working a strategy route right now. I apologize to everyone. It is not a Viper, but I'll talk about the Viper later if you want. I love Vipers.
There you see the class description. But well said, JB. I mean, Kevin Buckler really gives it 1,000,000%. He's the ultimate multitasker, has a lot of balls in the air at the same time. And GT Daytona, very fast GT cars, about 160 miles an hour, and they've embraced this full GT3 platform for this year for the first time in this championship, Greg, and that's why the grid has really swelled for this year.
Well, I think one of the reasons the interest is so peaked is because these are cars that you wish you could own, but if you had enough, you could own them. I mean, that's the thing. They are based on street-going supercars, and that is a great hook, like the Lamborghini Huracan here, the Pertamina entry in Monster Energy of Corey Lewis behind the wheel right now, and right behind them, another of the Huracans, but you've got the Audi R8 LMS. I mean, all of these cars, they're evocative, is really the way to put it, I think.
Well, if you're a young man, you'd love to have one in your driveway, in your garage, and for young boys and race fans, whether you're a boy or a girl for that matter, it could be a poster that you have on your bedroom wall, because They are so exotic, and it really brings out the passion in terms of cars and motor racing at the same time.
And we just saw a shot as we hop on board with Brett Curtis in that new AFE Power sponsored BMW M6 GT3 from Turner. But there you see Patrick Lindsay. Took him a while. He had to work his way by both Matt Bell and Tim Pappas, but now he has cleared them and he's been able to start to reel in Madison Snow. So Lindsay in that Park Place Porsche really putting on a good run here in the early going.
Well, he's the defending class champion here. Won last year with Spencer Pompelli.
Had the pole last year.
Had the pole, yeah. So he loves this place. He's very much at home, recently engaged. And you've got a cute story about that one, Greg. Lindsay.
Oh, yes. Well, yeah, congratulations to Patrick. He's getting, he got engaged, and it's going to be interesting because his fiance's first name is Lindsay. So,
Lindsay Squid.
That's right. That's right. But congratulations to the both of them as we have a look here. That's the 22 Cooper McNeil as he has caught the back of the 33 Viper. Ooh, and Keating floating way, way wide, Cal. That's the Viper Exchange Riley Motorsports car.
Yeah, and this Viper is really not kind of, a lot of the new cars, like the Porsche right behind him of Cooper McNeil, that's really been designed to the full GT3 specs. The Viper really hasn't. They've had some widgets and downforce and the rear diffuser and stuff like that, but, you know, it doesn't have the full downforce of maybe some of the other cars, and you can see Ben Keating pushing it for all it's worth, but talk about talent. His teammates, Ron Bliegermolen, what a man he is behind the wheel of this Viper. It's going to be a show at the end of this one.
Boy, no kidding, and Matt Bell is really starting to attack on Tim Pappas, a couple of cars up front. And as we were talking about it, watching obviously Christina Nielsen running in second. Well, her co-driver who ran with her to a win along with Jeff Siegel at Sebring is with Brian.
Yeah, Greg, and that win was the first for the 488 in GT3 form here in the WeatherTech Series. Also under a Balzon here at Laguna Seca. We saw in the GTLM category a 488, double stint tires in the end, different car, different tire, but when you look at this racetrack today, is that a strategy that you guys may be able to employ?
Well, Scuderia Corsa is doing really a great job here at Laguna. You know, it depends if some yellow comes out or not. Now Christina doing a really great job, really good start. She's managing really good the tires. I know the consumption are really concerned for us, so we will see during the driver change. If we have time, we will put the tires.
As far as fuel mileage goes as well, we saw teams kind of stretching fuel in GTLM and trying to make it to the end. The Ferrari seems to get reasonable fuel mileage. Just how far can you guys go, or are you going to tell me towards the end of the race?
No, it was a good experience, the GTLM race. We are working really hard on that, on the fuel consumption with Christina. And so we try really to stretch and to be quite aggressive.
I had to ask him about the fuel because I heard him on the radio early on talking about how to save fuel, make that stint just a little bit longer.
Thanks very much, Brian. We have a problem for the number 27 Dream Racing Lamborghini. That right rear wheel looks to be in some distress, Cal.
Some kind of issue with the right rear corner. It's a shame. This car was really quick up into the top five in the qualifying session, but changed their driver lineup. The qualifying driver has to start the race. They want to make a change, and that puts them to the back of the grid, so the team will look at this. The wheel is just loose. Oh, yeah, the upright is loose there. But the day may be over. It's a shame.
Yeah.
Very fast car this week.
Sure was. Cedric Spirazzoli, the young driver from Monaco, is so quick. And he qualified it, but then he decided to put Larry DeGeorge on and then problems at this stage. So, well, it's awful tough. That car had some serious potential as we go back to this interesting little scrap right now. And it is Pappas over Bell, over Keating, over McNeil. And we go back and see what's unfolding in that pit stop. It's going to be tough to make, if really affect that level of fix, I would think, in pit lane. It's certainly going to take a lot of time.
Here's a move down into the Andretti hairpin, I think. This is maybe where there was contact right there. That's what happened, I believe, to that right rear corner. He had contact with the 88 of Mark Kouame.
Yep, you can see that car starting to struggle already. So. Now the blocks come out. It's going to be a long fix for the Dream Racing number 27 of Larry DeGeorge. As we hop on board with Brett Curtis, we're going to step away from Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca. You ride around Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca behind the wheel of the thundering Viper Exchange.com Gas Monkey Garage Viper of Ben Keating. Unfortunately, he just got passed by Cooper McNeil. That is your overall race leader, James French, in the 38 Performance Tech entry that has just come down and made the pass. And interesting, Cal, watching Ben, particularly down into the Andretti hairpin, either he can't get that car turned or he's just trying to diamond the corner maybe to get a better runoff.
Yeah, he definitely floats up high in the middle of the corner. So he's struggling a bit down there and doesn't quite have the pace that he's looking for. But I tell you what, it's an impressive performance. Is Brett Curtis holding down the fifth position in that number 96 BMW M6 that we're looking at. He's got pressure from behind from Corey Lewis, Madison Snow there in the two Lamborghinis. But this is a great job in terms of a man who's really worked hard on his craft, a genuine pro-am driver, has a successful business. He's had Dan Cameron working with him as a driver coach for the last couple of years. And today, he's really stepping it up there. If he can hold this position down, Klingman could really do something with this car at the finishing stages of this race.
Well, clearly what Brian was talking about when they took him to Willow Springs and just let him do laps. Will Turner and the gang, that was a great call. We see quite a bit of Brett in our race announcing, and this is as good as I've seen him hustle a car. Yeah, great to see.
Look at the drop over the corkscrew, rainy curve. A little bumpier through there. This is a fun corner. It really compresses the car right there. You get some grip and release it and then set up for the brake zone. You Matt Bell there putting the pressure on Pappas.
Boy, he is just fierce. He is hungry. And I think part of it is the team's telling him Cooper McNeil's coming. You've got to get by.
Yeah, and you would expect Matt Bell to be a bit more towards the sharp end of this field right now. I mean, I know the Audi struggled a bit with setup early in the weekend, but Andrew Davis is sitting up there in the fourth position in the sister car.
Bell's going for it. Got the inside, but can he make it stick?
Keeps it clean, Coop McNeil. It's a drag race down the front straightaway. Coop McNeil gets to the inside lane. If he can hold the speed, he should take the position. It's a good opening stint by Cooper McNeil as well.
Yes, it is.
WeatherTech car is looking tough. There's Joe Bracing do such a great job with, excuse me, Greg, with these cars. And they are really scratching their head. They had some speed in the practice sessions, but then suddenly brake issues in the morning practice yesterday, and then in qualifying it reared its head as well.
They said, from what I understand, it was two completely different issues, or maybe one caused the other one, but it wasn't the same thing, was it?
It was not. They were really unsure. They were just going through it top to tail to try and figure it out and just give them a good, clean, and safe car for the race today. And that's the nice thing about that warm-up. You can just kind of quantify what the changes are and if you've got a clean bill of health for the race.
And as we were just looking there, the third car in the queue is Matt Bell in the Stevenson Audi. Well, the team car, one of the co-drivers is Robin Liddell, and he's standing by with Justin down in pit lane.
Yeah, you know, Robin Liddell, you're normally such a cheery, full of optimism kind of guy, aren't you? You're finding today a little bit tough, though. Everything's not quite going your way.
Well, you know, obviously we expected a learning curve. It's a new program. We've been a GM team for 8 years, I guess. You know, this was always gonna, it was a departure from what we were used to. So we expected a culture change with both within the team and in terms of our dealings with Audi, et cetera. And I think with how late we got the cars, et cetera, not testing before Christmas, which Magnus did, and really we saw the benefits of that for them at the first couple of events. I think we're in not bad shape with in terms of our basic preparation and our understanding of the car, but I think we're struggling a bit for pace right now. That being said, I think all the Audis are struggling. In all honesty, I think since the change after the Daytona test, the car has not really had great pace. It's had success at Daytona, but really over the 24 hours due to, you know, race execution. So I think we could do with a bit of pace, but also there are certain areas of the car which I think need more work around the Continental tire in terms of, you know, braking and front grip, etc. It's a great car to drive. The engine's package is great. It's high downforce and so on. But at this track especially, which, as you know, is very low grip and dusty, we're really struggling for front grip. And as soon as we try to really improve the front grip to any measurable extent, the rear becomes impossible to manage. So it makes for a difficult situation in terms of engineering and getting the best out of the current package.
And that was the Robin Liddell monologue
from the pit lane here at the Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca. Yeah, great that you come. No questions after that. Great job. Hey, but Calvin, I think what it really does show us as well is, you know, the Audi was developed on another brand of tires in Europe extensively. And it isn't just as simple as throwing on a different set, a different manufacturer, and it's compound construction. And these cars are so intrinsically in sync in development with them, with the tire manufacturer. We often overlook that, and it takes some time to get it up to speed. So they'll get there.
They will. I mean, it won the Ring 24-hour race in 2015, kind of on debut. So it's shown its speed. And as you say, Justin, different tires with the different championships. So it is difficult to make that transition over. But certainly the Stephenson group will get a handle on it. They're a quality group of guys coming off a championship win last year. And whilst we're talking Audi, quick shout out to Brad Kettler, who heads up the Audi customer racing program. And he's involved in a pretty severe street accident recently, so he's not at the racetrack this weekend, but get well, Brad. We're looking forward to seeing you back at the racetrack.
Boy, talk about a key component to the success of Audi in virtually every arena for years on the racetrack. That is pretty amazing, no question about it. And, you know, for Brad, absolutely, you're missed, to be sure. And for Robin Liddell, I mean, that was a long answer, but boy, what great information to kind of give us some insight as to what not just the Stephenson team, but the Audi teams are dealing with.
Absolutely, and a key component of this race is the 40-minute minimum drive time. We're just past that mark, so anyone could pit now if they choose to and be meeting that real requirement. But they're going to try and stretch this. I mean, we talked about the fact if you saw a little bit of yellow, it could be a one-stop. It's going to be tough to do under green flag racing all of the way, but we'll see what the strategy is amongst the various teams.
Well, you take a look right now. I mean, James French has almost a 20-second lead over Alon at this point. It's a lot closer behind him. You've got Popoff 2 seconds back. Goikberg has slipped just a little bit. You wonder if the idea from the performance tech team was just to say go, just build a huge margin. We're going to have to make two stops, so get some gap. And if Alon and the other guys maybe are going, just see if we can stretch things.
Yeah, maybe the group behind him, the pole sitting car, Bobby Orgel, is a pretty smart and savvy guy. Got John Hayes, an excellent engineer. Maybe they've just given him a fuel number that Robert Alon is trying to hit. And if you do that, maintain a position up towards the front of the field, we could do it on one stop and then turn it over to Tom Kimber-Smith.
I think it's going to be hard for the prototype challenge cars to make it on fuel, but one of the things they definitely are trying to conserve right now, and that may be going on with more teams than just the 8 from Starworks with Alex Popoff behind the wheel, is rear tires. Peter Barron's been on the radio a lot with Alex since the drop of the green flag, saying work your traction control, get the car as straight as you possibly can off the corner, save those rear tires. But you talk about the 40-minute mark, John Bennett is now in, and Colin Brown will be taking over the 54.
Cal, I mean, that leads to a question that maybe always Bennett is in, as you said, and Colin, boy, there's that play. There's a reason they've won these championships.
Yeah, they just have to make that call. Get him in, try and see if when the other leaders pit, whether Colin can then get the car back on the lead lap and do something with it. But it's going to be a deep hole to dig the way out of, starting from pit lane and going down a lap.
It's going to be fun to watch him try, though, isn't it? Colin Brown in one of these cars is spectacular, and he is out and on the track. And as he's about to re-enter, we're going to take a quick break, but we will be back to Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca.
We all remember our first car. Some were fast and some were cool. Colin, I think yours was in the cool category.
Yeah, it was. I got a 1972 Volkswagen Beetle that I've restored, my family restored with me, and really fun project, but not exactly super fast, but definitely cool.
What upgrades have you done? Because I hear it's a bit of a sleeper.
Yeah, it is. It's cool. It's got some different brake packages on it. It's my dad being a race engineer. We had to make the suspension work better, so bigger roll bars, upgraded engine as well. Also put some Continental True Contact tires on there that have Eco Plus technology, so it's really fuel efficient, which is great because my car has no fuel gauge.
I just had a visual. Yes, you are qualified to go along to the Woodstock reunion, but you will blow their bloody doors off.
You know, sometimes what you do for fun. What a great project that is, especially to work on with your dad. And yeah, he is flying already.
Yeah, he's a man on a mission right now. Got a lot of work to do, but very cool car. And You talk about track conditions here, Greg, and why are we sort of like seeing guys having to really manage their tires, and we say that this racetrack is low grip, it doesn't give a lot of abrasiveness to the tire, and what it means is the tire is going to slide across the road, and that basically wears out and overheats the tire, so it gets kind of greasy feeling underneath you, and I think that's what a lot of the drivers are feeling late in the stint here today.
That's thus the concern for trying to keep the rears underneath. And Colin, by the way, just turned it 121.2. That's a
fast lap by 8/10.
Yeah, fast lap. So.
But remember, there's going to be a lot of fast guns
well,
getting in
true.
These cars here in the next 15, 20 minutes.
That is very true. But I'll tell you what, James French, he's showing some stuff here. That's a good lap too. That 122.0 for a guy who's not considered a pro driver.
And that was on his qualifying tires, so obviously Colin has fresh rubber to lay down the mark he just did. But Alex Ribeiras, what a sensational run this is so far. Brilliant pole position here yesterday. Good clean run, stretching that lead now up to just under 12 seconds. So Christina's doing a nice job in hanging in there in that second position, and she's gapped Brandon Davis by some 12 seconds as well. So there's big gaps between first, second, and third right now.
Now you see the number 11 Change Racing Machine, the Robert Graham entry. I think Bill Sweetler has just stopped and turned that car over now to Townsend Bell.
It's the pairing that had to switch teams here. Started the year with Ogara Motorsports, and then they ceased operations, so it was really a bit of a panic for a few weeks there to find a new home, and they've done it here with Change Racing. This is a dynamic duo here. I mean, Bill Sweetler's another one of these gentlemen drivers who's really worked hard on his craft to he led legitimately last year. It was at VIR where he really put in an outstanding performance, and TB Townsend Bell always gets the job done.
Yeah, and I mean, it was a real effort, and I think a big round of thanks needs to go to Automobili Lamborghini for really working with them to be able to place them with Change Racing and help that team go from a single to a double car program. Keep them in the hunt, and whoa,
it's a spin for Tim Pappas. This is going to be key. If he can move or not, we could see a caution here. He's got pretty deep there. He's probably going to be beached. 50 minutes on the board. That would mean that we'd close the pits. By the time it's open, you're going to be pretty close to that halfway point where you might be able to make it on fuel. So I think we're going to see the pit lane really busy.
There's the double yellows.
How's this going to work out for guys like Colin Brown and guys like Townsend Bell, who just jumped behind the wheel?
Well, and also, Christina Nielsen, that margin that Ribeiras had opened up evaporates.
Yes.
Everything compresses.
Didn't see any other traffic involved in this incident from our camera shot. Here we see him. He's leading Ben Keating. Look at the entry there. Yeah, just a bit too much entry speed, maybe too much rear brake in the car, just turned it.
So while he is stuck, here's another look at it and watch it from the onboard.
Doesn't really touch the curb or anything. Just looked like the rear end locked up on him. Quite severe, actually. Could be a potential mechanical issue.
Brian?
Well, guys, literally the team was set up for a stop, and there was a crew member actually out at the wall two laps before that. I asked Jeremy Dale, who's sitting on the box here at Black Swan, what was going on. He said, we just don't have much grip. A lot of the cars are slowing down, and he's complaining about grip, and they were set up for a pit stop. He was literally coming in that lap, so maybe he should have come in last lap, but this is going to be an issue. A lot of the prototype challenge teams were set up to come in that lap, and with the pit lane closed, even though they're at part song, it still is another couple of laps they're going to have to run, and their tanks were already getting pretty low.
Yeah, you can take emergency service, but you're going to have to come down pit lane an extra time to make up for that. An emergency service really means something like you're running out of fuel, you have a flat tire, you have to come into pit lane even with the pit lane closed. Seems to be rolling okay, Greg, so I doubt if it is something mechanical. Maybe just got in there a little bit deep as he was turning in.
I wonder
if grabbed a downshift a little bit too early in the corner, possibly.
If they were talking about pit stop strategy, if I mean, just a little distraction over the
radio.
Doesn't
take much, particularly when the tires is Jeremy Dale, who's a really savvy guy in terms of what's going on with the race car, said, yeah, they were struggling for rear grip. And That combination may have just thrown Tim out of his rhythm a little bit.
I think right now he's just trying to talk to that EV worker and say, it's running, I can drive it. I just got to get turned around. So while that's being sorted out, we're going to step away. We anticipate a lot of pit stops coming. Well, apparently there may have been something that let go on board the number 540 Porsche. As you can see, it is on the back now of a flatbed as the cleanup continues here. And we continue under caution. And Cal, a lot of speculation going on as we're closing in. We're at 55 minutes and 40 some seconds. Being able to time everything for both the Prototype Challenge, but even more importantly for the GT Daytona cars, to do this with one stop.
Well, the big relief is that the pits are finally open, so the PC cars can come down, and some of them may have been literally on fumes. And I don't believe anyone had to take that emergency service route in terms of being out of gas and having to hit pit lane. This is all legitimate pit stops right now. And now it's down to the crew. James French did his job. The crew has to do theirs as he turns it over to Marcelli. GB?
Yeah, the 38, obviously the first car to hit pit lane the very early on in the pit stalls. So that is definitely an advantage and a nice clean gap for them to do their driver change. And of course, we're seeing such it's driver assist there. You can see in the top of the car, new tires going on. Continental's ready for this. And I think this is a pretty tidy stop for them. The front left gun going on right now. Now, of course, this is very important not to lose any time in the pits right here as he's having a little trouble getting it going.
Well, down at the 52, Robert Alon, the pole sitter, is out. Tom Kimber-Smith is in. Remember, this guy certainly knows how to pedal one of these cars. The other car on pit lane, the 54, Colin Brown. He came in, topped it off with fuel, beat everybody back out.
Smart move. I saw that car come in, and I thought, they should have a very short stop to top off. They got fresh tires. Great roll of the dice.
Yeah, they're savvy, and they'll get the they should get the wave around. So you'd think, okay, you're a lap down, stay out. No, fill him up with fuel, beat the others out. So you're still effectively on the lead lap. Should get the wave around. So great move. They're the best in the business in terms of calling those sort of strategy ploys.
Yeah, and all right, guys, down in the pits, it's going to get real busy for you. Pits open for GT Daytona.
Massive and, field coming in at once.
There's a look at Colin with that play. As you said, he's at the back of the GTD cars, but he's back on the lead lap of the race when they all pit. And I would think almost every one of them should, shouldn't
they? Yeah, most of them. We've had a couple of cars that have been in and done their driver changes, obviously of the 11 with Townsend Bell behind the wheel. Actually, Freiburg is now behind the wheel of the 88, take note from Mark Kwame. She had a brilliant podium run. We talk about Christina Nielsen, girl power at Sebring, getting the victory in GTD. Let's not forget that Ashley Freiburg, who's running the PC class here, had a GTD podium with Turner Motorsports at that event also. Look at Riberas. That is smart. Look at that. He's just taken off there. Michael Marcel there is staying out. So big gap there for Riberas over Christina Nielsen as these two are 1-2 effectively in the class as they hit pit lane.
Mario Farnbacher jumping in the 23. They're ahead of their sister car, the 22, thank goodness, in order on the pit box because this gets very busy right now. Obviously, four new tires going on. Driver change, getting him all buckled in. It's chaos down this end. What about you, Brian?
It is busy down here at Scuderia Corsa as well. Alessandro Bolzon taking over from Christina Nielsen. Now, these two drivers pretty different in size. So, and I see no seat insert. So that's interesting because I do not believe this has a slider seat in it. We'll have to take a look and see if Alessandro moves that seat forward. No, he does not. So they've got a seating position that will work for both of them. Four Continental tires just waiting for fuel. Driver change is done. Waiting, 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 and as we wait, the 23 goes by. Justin?
We had the number nine, Stevenson Audi was in at 45 degrees to the pit wall. Thank goodness the car in front just went out. This pit is so busy, everyone having to work with each other, yet try and optimize their own pit stop. Everyone was clean as far as I could see, Brian. Good run here.
Wow, that was anxious there. You could see the lollipop man on the Ferrari just started shaking at it. Come on. Top him up. We want to get him going so he could beat the BMW. It looks like the Turner boys had a good stop there. Klingman Nam behind the wheel.
Yeah, that was a great stop. Leapfrogged up a couple of spots. And we know Jens can fly. This is going to be fun. Don't go anywhere. In 1991, Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca witnessed the debut of the fastest, most dominant prototype ever built in the U.S., the Dan Gurney All-American Racing Eagles. And it was an amazing debut. Qualified second, however, it was Wayne Taylor in the full downforce Intrepid that put in a one-lap flyer, but at the start, the car just checked out. They had some problems with some pit penalties and ended up back in seventh. But that car in the next year, in 1992, showed up and decimated the championship. In 1993, P.J. Jones set the outright track record at this facility, and that happened to be a 1 minute 11.294 second lap. That's some 8 seconds quicker than the prototype pole here this year. And we're back to green as the prototype challenge cars make the move. And right off the bat, a change. It's number 52 of Tom Kimber-Smith, who goes into the lead. Here comes the GT Daytona field as well.
It was really close as they exited their pit box. The eight car, in fact, beat them out, but had a blend line violation. As here it gets really close. Ring of Anderzander putting it all on the line, trying to take the lead immediately. Kimber-Smith tries to protect. This is while Van der Zand is going to get a run here off of turn four. Simpson's running the mix as well, coming off that win at Sebring.
This is great stuff. The car that was leading sits there now in the fourth spot with Kyle Marcelli. Up the hill we go. And let's not forget Johnny Molam now on board the Bar One car as well.
And he had a win here back in 1999. So that's how long Johnny Molam's been coming here and having success.
Watch up here into the course. Drew Simpson's close. Close enough that Renger van der Zande needed to dissuade him just a little bit. Down the hill they go, and that allows Tom Kimber-Smith to open a gap up, Cal.
That is a big gap. I thought Renger van der Zande would be right on his tail, but he's not feeling the heat from behind, so maybe he recognized he wanted to try and get. Oh, he's pushed wide. He is really wide there in the dust. Simpson goes to the outside for the brake zone for turn 11.
Then Simpson locks him up big time. That slows him up. Marcelli almost able to get a run, but now Simpson right behind van der Zande. He's in the draft down into the Andretti hairpin.
The Flying Dutchman coming under attack by Steven Simpson. The South African guy goes to the inside, locks up the brakes. Both guys absolutely on the limit. Threshold braking with their Continental tires.
I haven't seen that much brake smoke in a long time.
Was there a flat spot?
Limit. Yeah, exactly.
That's the key. Looked like he released them. Great job though, but that's the quality of drive. You get in there too deep, he just didn't plow straight on. He released the brake pedal and got going beautifully.
Oh, and Kimber-Smith lost a little bit of that margin, trapped behind the Magnus Audi. The 88 car, we're getting a report, Ashley Freiberg is going to have to do a drive-through penalty for spinning the wheels while on the jacks in pit lane. And the 88, that was also a too fast on pit lane. So that's the development there.
Oh, here comes Molam. He makes a move.
On Marcelli.
Wow. 38 car from the lead is now back in the fifth spot.
And that's got to be a bit frustrating as down in pit lane, the gentleman who led so impressively, James French, watches.
Yeah, James, I just wanted to have a chat because you really deserve the attention. That was a stunning run, mate. Nice to come in the lead, right?
Yeah, thank you so much. Yeah, we didn't quite get the start that we wanted, but we're able to make the two spots, get back in the lead, pull out a pretty nice gap. And I was hoping we were going to get to keep it after the pit stop, but we had the caution and everybody stacked back up, but it was definitely a fun stint.
Great, I'm just going to move past it. Alex, quickly, Alex Ramirez came in also in the 23 in the lead. Alex, that was a strong stint coming in the lead of your pack.
Absolutely. I mean, such a special race for us, both for me, for Mario and I. Since we were in Seattle for the last 2 weeks, we were with the kids from the Seattle Children's Hospital, and we promised them we're going to come here and win this race. So we're going for it, and now it's up to Super Mario to get the job done.
Yeah, well said. Guys, I have two leaders right side by side. How convenient is that, Brian?
Well, you know who else is trying to run up front? That's the 90 cents of Jens Klingman in that BMW. Brett Curtis, what a spectacular job in the opening stints. It seems like you've really come to grips with this car.
Thank you very much. Man, Turner did a great job on this BMW. It was set up really, really great. It was just really fortunate that I could stay ahead of the two Lamborghinis that were hounding the heck out of me, and I'm really happy we had a good balance. And man, we just tried to stay in it. I was really happy that yellow couldn't have come at a better time. I was ready to come in and give it to Jens.
I'm not even sure he was really driving. Look at him, he's not even sweating out there. But hey, another thing that happened during that last pit stop, or that last yellow, I should say, on the final lap of that, the 54 prototype challenge was back in, topped it with fuel. They're on the lead lap, and they may very well be good to go all the way to the end. The 96 is good on fuel.
Wow, this is really gonna get interesting here in how this all plays out. But it didn't take long for Tom Kiffert-Smithgau to get back to the lead, and he has immediately been able to stretch a little bit of a margin now over Simpson and Vanderzanden.
Yeah, he withstood the pressure there. He's under the attack, obviously, as we could see some Renger Vanderzanden, but then he just stroked away from the rest of this PC field. Simpson now into the second position. Let's see if the 85 car has anything for him.
Now the 23 still leads, but look at the 63 Balzan right there as well, and not far behind them is Klingman. There's that white number 96 Turner BMW. The guns are on board, and this is going to be interesting.
Wow, we're hearing some penalties for the 38 and the 16 car. 38 car pass under yellow. I believe that was when maybe James French was still behind the wheel when Tim Pappas was off there in the gravel trap. The 16 car has also got a penalty for too many men over the wall. That's devastating for Spencer Pampali, who's going for his second straight victory here in GTD.
On board with Klingman down the hill. Sits in third right now. The 007 of Davison is fourth. Liddell rounds out the top five.
You've got some talent out there right now, led by Farnbacher Balzan. He won a World Challenge event here at Laguna Seca, last round of the championship in 2015. Klingman. He's a BMW factory driver. You got James Davison right behind them. And then Rob Nadell, Bleekemol, and Sellers, Keane, Aschenbach. There's no weak spot in the top 10.
Back here a little bit is a guy, Bergmeister, had some success here as well. So, yeah, this is serious, serious stuff right now. And Balzan is, looks like he is able to just stay right put right now with Mario Farnbacher.
So Alessandro at Daytona back at January at the test, he did not have a ride. He was walking around the paddock, chatting, trying to find something. Then he got the call that he was finally confirmed to drive this car alongside Christina Nielsen. And boy, oh boy, he is an amazing talent.
Delightful guy, too. Just really loves it, loves racing here in the U.S.
Great coach. Been working with some of the other Scuderia Corsa drivers in other championships. Martin Fuentes. Been dominant in his class this year. This racetrack is so much fun to drive, Greg. It's a roller coaster coming down that hill. You have to hit your marks. The track grip is changing as the sand blows across the surface. Very warm conditions here in the race today. 79 degrees ambient, about 110 track temp. That's the warmest they've seen all weekend long, I believe.
You can see some of the compression. We've talked about it in turn six, but even more so in turn 10. Right when they apex, you got a little puff of smoke coming off of that left rear fender well, and that's just the bodywork compressing right down onto the tire because of that compression and load.
You're right on the skid plates of the chassis. As you say, the suspension is fully loaded and the body's coming down, getting a little bit of tire rub. Right now, you see these cars on exit, they look pretty balanced, and as this stint wears on, you're gonna see them starting to slip and slide just a little bit more as the drivers are asking for more from their Continental tires.
Just to keep you appraised up front overall, Tom Kiffert-Smith has opened it up to about 3 seconds over Simpson as we continue to watch this enthralling battle here in GT Daytona. And there's a pretty impressive very impressive manufacturing presence in this category as well. It's on a customer level. It's not full out factory teams, but believe me, they're interested and they are involved. Get word, good news for the 38. That penalty has been rescinded. They reviewed it and said they do not have to do the drive-through, but for Marcelli, that would have been problematic as he slipped back, sitting in fourth right now. Just a little over a second clear of Molum.
Tell you what, these GTD front runners are really finding the sweet spot now as the tires are coming up to pressure and temperature. Farnbacher around a 26-1, Balzan a 26-1, bunch of guys down in the 26 range.
Behind them, Klingman, Davison fourth, Liddell, then Bleekemolen has taken over for Ben Keating. And talk about a world-class talent, Giroux now has wheeled that big Viper up into fifth.
And that's a man who drives about 35 to 40 times a year. Yes. He is so busy, so many different racing programs. Just loves his racing. Based out of Monaco. Wonderful young man and brilliant talent.
Wondering what we're going to see here from Eric Bergmeister. The problem was he came out of the pits and he's quite a ways down the order still.
Yeah, he's got some ground to cover.
Yeah, he does.
Also, what can Lee Keen do with a now what seems healthy 22 WeatherTech machine? The sister car to the leading machine right now. Both cars fielded by Alex Job Racing.
Right now, I'm sorry, Cal, looking at the mix we have up front in GTD, you've got the rear engine Porsche, the mid-engine Ferrari, the front engine BMW. Just going to start to see some flux in terms of which car is better.
Well, I would have thought that the balance would stay with the Ferrari, but I mean, this Porsche pace here this weekend has been phenomenal. I think they've led every session in GTD. So they've really found a sweet spot with the setup. Sometimes it's just hard to play catch up. Limited track time with the split classes here, two different races. I think there's a total of about 2 hours track time prior to the race today. That's not a lot of time if you roll off the trailer without the right setup on. And it's good news if you hit the sweet spot immediately.
And along with everything else, you even in GT Daytona, you have to keep mindful of those tires.
Absolutely. It's going to be a long stint. If they can stretch it on fuel, what are the tires going to be like? Over an hour possibly on this run. They're going to be in fuel save mode. They think they're going to do it under green flag racing without another stop.
A little bit of room from Klingman now back to Davison. Some 5 seconds. As you ride on board with Lee Keen in the WeatherTech Porsche from Alex Job Racing. There's your top three in GTD. Welcome back, everybody. A look there. It's called Adobe Road Winery, and it's one of the efforts and businesses that Kevin Buckler right there in the background from the Racers Group put together, and he likes to joke. He said it's a 15-year overnight success, and basically they've grown, and they've outgrown their digs in Sonoma. They are building a brand new waterfront facility in downtown Petaluma right on the river. So they have basically disassembled their entire tasting room from Sonoma, brought it down, and it's been set up here in the paddock. Boy, what a great story that winery program is. And of course, for the Racers Group, Cal, just a lot of years of tremendously successful racing.
Yeah, I mean, superb record with their racing program, and the wine is pretty special too.
Yeah,
they've won awards over the years as well. So Kevin Buckler, he does everything right.
Including the drivers he chooses for his cars oftentimes. And
boy,
right
fighting
now,
it.
He is something though, isn't he?
He was in really deep into the Andretti hairpin there. So his teammate is pushing really hard here. What does Brandon Davis have to say, JB?
Well, Brandon, as Calvin just said, your teammate's pushing very hard. You push very hard. The car looked very settled, actually. I was talking with Kevin earlier. He said you really having to run it to a certain pace and make the most of the car you have here. Was that the case?
Yeah, I mean, the balance on the car was pretty good. I think we were trying to look after the rear tires more than anything, because being a front engine car, you know, trying to just keep that tire life throughout the whole stint. And I think we did a good job of that. You know, I don't know that we have the pace to maybe go out front and, you know, take the lead that way, but I think we have a good overall pace and, you know, no mistakes and see what we can end up with.
Does he give you a bonus in wine?
What's that?
Does he give you a bonus if you do well in wine?
You know, I'm going to have to ask about that.
Yeah, he's a bit mean with it, just so you know.
He is.
He's throwing that out there.
Yeah,
exactly. That's why he's got all the money.
I don't think Kevin turns loose a wine down there, Justin. If anybody would have gotten it, it would have been you. But let's talk about tires real quick. I checked in with the Scuderia Corsa team about the balance of the car at the end of the stint for Christina Nielsen. Remember that Ferrari being mid-engine was very nice to the tires in the GTLM category. Well, guess what? It's very nice to these Continentals in the GTD category. She told me that as long as you take care of them early on, you'll have good tires underneath it at the end. So Alessandro Balzan literally saw him having a little espresso just before he put his helmet on. He's got good Continental tires. It should be good to go all the way to the checkered flag.
I think this battle is going to be something special to watch here. And if Jens Klingman stays close, we'll see. But these two guys, 1-2 right now, Cal. Boy, I tell you, they are sharp.
Well, Balzan races hard, but he also races very clean. He is a true gentleman both on and off the racetrack, so he doesn't typically dig deep and get dirty, so he's going to just try and hound Farnbacher here, see if there's a weak point that he can really take advantage of.
There's the corkscrew once again. Love that high shot. Just gives you a feel for how far they drop as they plummet down this hill. There's that compression down into turn 10.
It's just a rhythm that you just have to hit. And if the car's working, it is a lot of fun. If it's a little bit off, it is extremely, extremely frustrating. And the harder you work it, it's almost the worse it gets. So the engineers did their job right. You gave them the right information. It can be very satisfying for the driver.
And as we talked about it at the top of the show, if somebody runs a little wide, some of that sand gets up on the track, or you get a strong enough breeze even here at times, it can literally change, not lap to lap, corner to corner, doesn't it?
It does. You're really very much on your toes. Keeping a grip, as we said, is one of the keys to victory here. You cannot afford to make a mistake. Seen a couple of drivers run off. Has hurt their day. Right now, the leaders are very much in their sweet spot. So you see Balzan really pushing it deep into turn five. Looks like that Ferrari may have a little bit of understeer at this stage of the game, but could be good towards the end. It's not going to overwork the rear tires too much.
And I know they want to protect those rears, but would it be worth it to maybe attack that Porsche a little bit? Because with that engine right over those drive wheels, it's a lot of pendulum weight back there.
Well, I think the other factor is, of course, fuel as well. Yep. You know, how hard do you want to push him to use his tires up, and how much fuel are you going to burn in doing that?
It's always that compromise. One thing directly affects another, and you've got to always drive big picture.
We're talking about fuel in both classes here today with the timing of that yellow. We're looking at the GTD class, but Brian, I know you've been speaking to some of those PC teams. What's everyone saying in terms of fuel mileage and if they can get to the finish without the need for a trip down pit lane and a splash?
Well, you got to think about who pitted when. So on that full course caution, obviously all the leaders came in. The 52 came in. Tom Kimber-Smith got behind the wheel. They filled it with fuel and off they go. We also saw Ringer van der Zande get in the eight. Steven Smith, get in the JDC car, the 85. So they all stopped on the same lap, but then the 54 came in at the end of that yellow on the third lap. So he has two more laps of fuel. So he's got a better shot at it. But then you have to take the drivers into consideration. I talked to Bobby Orgel about Tom Kimber-Smith. He said he's hard on fuel. He burns a lot of it. He's a left foot breaker, drives the car deep into the corner, and somewhat of a go-karter, as I would call it. He taps the throttle a couple of times to point the car on the way out. Every one of those taps on the throttle burns fuel. So that's an issue. I asked Chris Miller up at JDC how Steven was on fuel, and he said he's typically pretty smooth. So it's not only gonna come down to how much fuel is in the tank, but how the driver uses that gas pedal, and more importantly, where he doesn't use it. You know, the interesting thing here, out of the corkscrew at times, you can coast a little bit down the hill if you're right behind somebody. Every drop they save is gonna be precious.
Yeah, it's a little bit, we used to talk about it a lot with Scott Pruitt, one of the fastest guys, so many championships and race wins in the prototype class, but he was the same thing, what we call that go-kart style. He balances the car on the throttle as he's going through the corner. He blap, blap, blaps on the throttle, trying to keep the car on edge so he can rotate it through the corner and keep the balance exactly where he wants it. What Brian is saying, TKS, Tom Kimber-Smith, does the same thing with the lead car right now, but you got to be patient. Sometimes it's hard just to be rolling off power all the way through the corner. As a race driver, you just want to get going. There's that temptation to hit the right pedal once again early.
The classic example of treating it like the eggs underneath the throttle, and then short shifting. I mean, there are little things you can do to carry a little higher gear through certain parts of the track. I mean, you do what you have to, really, don't you?
Yeah, short shifting certainly helps in terms of changing to the next gear before you're fully wound out of revs in the preceding gear. But really rolling out of the power early is the best way to do it. Like up into the corkscrew, just coasting maybe 10 yards before you get to the brake pedal. That's when you get that true fuel save.
It's an art, isn't it?
It
is. The drivers that can do it well are a pretty valuable commodity, much like the fuel itself.
We saw Richard Westbrook do it this afternoon in the earlier race for Ford GT, getting their first victory in the GTLM class. He just did a brilliant job of just managing the fuel, basically going 5 minutes further than what a full fuel stint should have gone. And that got him a victory of the one-stop strategy.
On board with Bleekemolen, and that little dot you see up in front of him by about 3 seconds is Robin Liddell. And that is the fifth place car. So Bleekemolen sits sixth. Brian Sellers really a lot closer behind him. in that seventh spot in that Paul Miller race in Castrol at Universal Industrial Sales, Lamborghini Huracan.
There's Brian making the switch to the GTD class this year. Ran for so many years with Derek Walker in the Falcon Tire GTLM program. He's found a nice home here, though, with Paul Miller Racing. We talk about that driver pairing. I think Brian's talents and speed, along with young Madison Snow, is going to be making some statements here this year.
Yeah, he said he really feels like he's found another home. And I think that's that means a lot to a race driver, doesn't it?
It does. It's early days. I mean, we've only got two races under our belts. Admittedly, it's 36 hours of racing with Daytona and Sebring. But
you learn a lot about people in those races.
You do, and they haven't done any real testing since Sebring. So I think they need a few test days, and that will help the chemistry build, understand the car a little bit more, understand what it needs, particularly on these compact weekends in terms of time schedules and a couple hours of track running. You have to make the right moves. They found on Friday the car was totally out to lunch, had a differential issue, made a change overnight, and Saturday it started to come alive, but you're a little bit behind. You're a session or two behind. It's hard to catch up.
Just riding on board there with Lee Keen, the number 22 WeatherTech Porsche. And there's a pretty good little queue of cars here, basically from ninth, which is Aschenbach, right behind Keen, up to Robin Liddell. They're compressed fairly close together. Then there's about a 4 second gap between James Davison, who sits in the fourth spot, back to Liddell. And then, of course, we've seen it here, Feinbacher, Balzahn, and Klingman, all in relatively close concert, although Klingman has dropped off by about 3 seconds, Cal.
He has, and I think some of that, remember the strategy there. Don Salama's one of the best in the business. Let's not forget that victory that Dane Cameron had last year at Lime Rock, where he went about 20 minutes further with Don Salama just coaching him around the race circuit, giving him fuel numbers to reach. And I think for Klingman, he'll be in that BMW, definitely working on the fuel strategy, the fuel number to enable that BMW to not need a splash of fuel.
You know, that's one of the things that's always impressed me about Don Salama when he made the move to the top of the pit box, was not only can he conceive of this of these ideas, but he convinces Will Turner to try them. And because he makes them work.
He does. Will's a believer. And sometimes we question when he's outside the box so far, like he was at Lime Rock last year, but he pulled it off. Just a magical performance there by that whole team. We call Don Salama the Iceman, but that's for a different reason.
A lot of people scratching their heads how they still, I think, how they pulled that one off. Well, a bit earlier, we heard from Justin Bell starting to talk about Vipers. Now it's time to do it for real. JB?
Well, you know, Matt Dalton, Englishmen are the only ones in the pit lane, you know. Oh, and Brian. Sorry about that, everybody, but now I am going to talk about a Viper. So the number 33 Gas Monkey Energy car, just was talking with Jim Riley, and he said, you know, the Bill Riley, he said, God, I can't get anything right today. Bill was just saying, he said, you know, their car really heaviest in class, really too heavy for this track in this temperature. It's 27 degrees hotter than they've experienced the rest of the weekend, Cal. So, you know, tires are working hard, air drivers are working hard. They're running, you know, the one thing that Bill can bring to it with his driver, you know, Bleek Molin's, you know, so disciplined as a driver, they're just having to hold it together and really drive the car tight in order to try and make it last to the end. It has an understeer, believe it or not, and the temptation is to set it up, to give it a bit of oversteer to balance that out, but then that's a disaster in a Viper. Take it from me, shameless plug, I did clinch the world championship here in a Viper. But I have to redeem myself some way. But you know, so there's everyone working up and down the pit lane here, but Heath, I don't know if Brian's heard anything about track temperature down his end, but definitely, you know, it's a hot part of the day as the evening sun starts to come in.
Yeah, we did get a note from Continental Tire, and Sherry Herman kind enough to give us the information. It was up around 110 at the green flag to this race this afternoon, JB, so certainly a lot warmer, as Bill Riley explained to you, than what they've experienced throughout the early part of the weekend.
Somebody dropping a tire there pretty big, sending up a plume.
Tom Kimber-Smith, our overall leader there, making a move inside of Balzahn, who continues to run in the second position, but he's been split by a couple of cars now. Ashley Freiberg is in there in a PC car. Now Tom Kimber-Smith as well.
Absolutely, should pull out, make
Freiberg has cleared the GTD leader.
And up and through. There we go, and while we watch this, our two class leaders, the Let's check in with Brian.
All right, guys, so check this out a little bit. Another car you're going to see back on the racetrack is the 540. Tim Pappas is out of it. Nikki Katzberg is in. Saw that car with a problem earlier, and indeed it had a mechanical problem. So this is one of the front wheels, and obviously the hub goes in here like this. But what happened to this car when they got it back to the garage, they looked and they realized that the wheel was scored inside. So something got between the hub and the wheel itself, and it actually tore the right front brake line off. So think about Tim Pappas in that car. He goes to apply the brakes. One of the brake lines is completely ripped off. All the fluid goes out. The pedal goes to the floor. Not what you really want here in turn five.
Yeah, that looked like a lot of rear brake, but you shouldn't be hitting the brakes that hard. So it was a tough one to call at the time, but that totally explains it. Great job, Brian.
Yeah, thanks very much. Great to know they're back. Well down. Took a lot of laps to repair. Good to have them on. There's another look at it. Boy, I mean, it's just sudden.
Yeah, he was lucky he didn't get into a tire wall around a different part of the racetrack.
Absolutely. There is Balzan now that he's just going to have some PC traffic working by both of these guys for a while. And he's able to look like make up a little bit of that, but right there, that's just going to slow you down big time.
Yeah, and it's strange. I mean, traffic can affect you when you're passing slower cars, but also when faster cars are coming by you in terms of where they do it, how aggressive they get. If they kind of stove it down the inside into a corner, you lose all of the momentum and you lose that gap to the leader. So right now, Balzan has not had a good run with this PC faster traffic coming through.
Oh, and Simpson now trying to work around Farnbacher. Makes that work. Pinch Farnbacher a little bit. Or at least Farnbacher was moved over to make sure he gave him plenty of room.
Van der Zander has gotten around Steven Simpson for the second position. It's been a recent change. Remember, Simpson got by Van der Zander after the restart in the initial laps there.
And that last lap, Van der Zander was significantly quicker than Tom Kuemper-Smith.
Yeah, so maybe they just set the car up for the longer run here, and it's starting to pay dividends, because certainly Ringo Van der Zander, I mean, I know he put the pressure on Tom Kuemper-Smith right at this part of the racetrack on the opening restart lap. But then he just faded dramatically. Maybe they're just on low tire pressures to start the run, and now it's coming into the sweet spot as the others are fading a little bit.
And that car right in the middle, the second car, the black one there, that's the Popcorn Sutton number 88 from Star Wars Motorsports, Ashley Freiberg, who is down a lap at this stage, so that she is not in this battle for position.
There's Van der Zander. He just gave that Viper a little nudge there, so I'm not sure if that was kind of a payback in terms of Mike Skeen not giving him room somewhere around the racetrack, whether it was just a misjudgment, but definitely a little rub there with the 80 machine as they headed towards turn five.
Yeah, but not a surprise. Skeen running laps as fast as anybody at the front of the GTD field right now. Problem is, he's just way down the order.
He's a real talent.
Oh, is he?
Lost his full-time ride this year in a different championship and had to scramble, and he's found a nice home here, but he's won here at this racetrack a couple of times before. Loves the place, and great to see him showcasing his abilities once again.
Yeah, I've referred to him for a long time, and confoundingly, as America's best-kept secret, he is that good. Oh, boy. Oh, huge move by Ranger Van der Zander. Wanted to get by both those cars, and now has some clear track, and we'll see if he can set sail after Tom Kuemper-Smith.
Yeah, he's on a mission right now, but look at that rear wing end plate. It's fell down. It shouldn't hurt him too much, as long as that main element is not going to come detached or lose angle, because that would be a big problem.
Right now, it might just be channeling air beautifully out the top of the car. And Balzan, once again, everybody clears out. He's able to close it back up just a little bit on Mario Farnbacher. There's the 23, there's the 63. 1-2 in GTD.
Both these drivers, though, you can see the balance is still there with the cars. You don't get that little fishtailing coming off the corner, a little oversteer condition as you're exiting the turns yet, but still 24 and a bit minutes to go. And again, we talked about Westbrook. He had good tires at the end of his run by doing that one stopper today. When you're saving fuel, it also saves the tires. You're not as aggressive on the gas pedal, Greg, so that may be playing a part here, too, in terms of looking at the two leaders in how the cars are handling.
That's sort of a weird variant of the old driver instructor mantra, slow down, go faster.
I know, it's amazing what sort of lap time you can achieve when you just sort of like roll out the gas early, carry rolling speed through the corner rather than braking late and then jumping on the gas pedal. It's easier on the tires, the balance stays with you, but it's a real technique, a rhythm, and sometimes you have to adapt, particularly to a new circuit when you suddenly get told by your engineer, okay, we can do it without coming back to pit lane, but you have to save fuel. You've got to roll speed through the corners. Don't brake as deep. Don't stay on the gas pedal as long and then brake deeper. Roll out of the gas, brake a little bit sooner, coast through the middle of the corner, pick up the throttle a little bit later or a little bit smoother.
And right now, Farnbacher, I think, has caught Andy Lally. And we'll see whether he's able to sneak through quickly as we first jump on board with Jens Klingman. About 3 seconds back of that battle for the lead right now. And look, Davison sits fourth. Robin Liddell in that fifth spot up front. Tom Kimber-Smith has about 3 seconds in hand over Renger van der Zande. And Steven Simpson tops them. Going to the checkers when we come back. ...20 minutes remain here at the Continental Tire Monterey Grand Prix, powered by Mazda at Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca. And having a look right there, that's the Stevenson Autosport Audi, and then one of our Lamborghinis. Just a great blend of cars here that are running, and that is the that was the Aschenbach car. There's Townsend Bell right behind him. And tell you, these guys, Cal, that are running just a little bit farther back in the order, they're just not right now showing the pace to be able to get up and do anything with that lead group, but they are very close together from Bleekemolen and really all the way back Townsend Bell. It's pretty tight.
It really is. I mean, the two leaders have run 126.1s, Klingman are 126.4. As you mentioned, Skeen and Lally have run some nice laps, 26.3s, but everyone else is bunched around those high 26 or low 27 range, so it's very tight.
Look there at Spencer Pumpelly. Yeah, we have talked about this track being a roller coaster track, and he has seen the highs and lows of this place, Spencer has.
He certainly has. It looked like he had a wind going and ran out of fuel coming down the hill 1 year. And this year, he could have been at the sharp end. They had that penalty for too many men over the wall, I believe it was four. So he's digging deep here, trying to come up with something. He and Corey Lewis. Corey Lewis won one of the Lamborghini races earlier this weekend from the tail end of the grid. Didn't set a qualifying time. Skied through the whole field and won that race. So that's another very strong driver combination for the season.
Yeah, it is. Corey did a nice job in his opening stint. It's just a shame about that penalty. I love this shot right here. That run up into the corkscrew.
That is awesome.
Here's the drop.
Boom. You literally can't see anything. You're sort of like turning the wheel based on timing and some visual reference points up off of the racetrack. You cannot see the road there as you plunge over the hill in the corkscrew.
You almost sort of, you point the car at trees, and at one point all you see is sky. I mean, it's just crazy.
It's awesome.
Well, I mean, that was the one thing Alex Ribeiro said. This is his first time here, and Alex said that part of the track reminds me of the feel sometimes of the Nürburgring. He said it's just that crazy.
Yeah, I mean, the European drivers just love coming to this racetrack. You kind of feel at home, even though they haven't been here before. It's a nice fit.
That's the Andretti hairpin. And, I'll tell you, I just can't fathom. I was unfortunately never able to get out here before they made that infield section a permanent part of the track. When as you got to where you'd make that left-hand hard turn into the Andretti hairpin, you just kept it pinned and followed around the route. Came right up at turn five and continued on up the hill.
I raced there once under that configuration. It was mind-blowing how quick it was through there. Like the speed kept building, and each corner got tougher and tougher until you got to that key corner, turn six, and you're hitting at a lot more speed.
I was going to say that corner must have been diabolical back in that era. But that new infield section down there, you know, we've heard drivers have talked about the fact that the track now it almost presents in a way with two different tracks. You've got that very flat section, essentially, from 11 all the way to 5. And then you've got all of those, which is just the changes and the flow. And then you've got the climb. It's just a very different feel to it.
It is. The name Laguna Seca is Spanish for dry lake. actually added those two reservoir ponds after they built the circuit. 1957, I believe, is the first race here. So it's been a long time in operation, and Jill Campbell and her whole staff do an excellent job here.
Yeah, truly do. And the one thing, I mean, it's one, it's a state park, and two, it's also set. There are fences around here, and you don't want to go on the other side of the fences because this park is built right in the middle of what used to be an old ordnance testing facility for the military.
Tell you what, Farnbacher is stretching this lead. This is, if they can complete the task here, this has been really a dominant performance by this 23 group this whole weekend. As you mentioned, a change of driver lineup for the sprint races and for the full season. It's going to be Alex Ribeiros and Mario Farnbacher now driving together, and Ian James just doing the Enduros. That could be a mega move by that group.
Oh, without, yeah, his last lap was 8 tenths quicker than Balzan's. Balzan responds this time, but still loses another 2 tenths. So, yeah, Mario has definitely got the bit right now.
You have to manage it. It'd been very easy for him to get in the pole sitting car, having the lead, jumping straight out there and just going really, really hard and burning those tires down. He had to be very disciplined here, I think, in the first half of this stint to make sure that he had something if there was a regroup with a caution and suddenly you got cars around you with better tires. No point in just disappearing off into the distance.
And the margin from Balzan back to Klingman remains about the same. It's gone to about 3.9 seconds. It's been in that 3.5 to 4 second range for a little bit. Then it's a bigger margin of some 5 seconds back to James Davison in fourth.
And again, fuel mileage is still going to be a critical factor here for most of the GTD teams and the PC teams. A lot of guys, if they haven't been saving fuel, they'll be looking for a caution. Otherwise, they are going to be in fuel trouble.
Up front, the margin, 2.8 seconds. Tom Kimber-Smith in front of Renger van de Zande. And then another 8 seconds back to Steven Simpson.
Yeah, I wonder if he's lost the balance on the race car of the championship leading number 85, or whether he's in a more of a fuel-saving mode as well. Lost pace with van der Zander. I truly think that maybe the car, in terms of the setup, came to Renger a little bit. He was really struggling for grip there when we went back to green. Yeah. Put the attack on Kimber-Smith, but couldn't do anything then and fell way back. Now he's got some pace once again.
He doesn't. Looking at the margins here, Simpson is less than a second clear of Marcelli, but he's got 7 seconds on Colin Brown, which in a way is pretty impressive considering where they were here.
Look at Colin Brown's laps.
Yeah.
Just. He just laid down a 120.3. That was on lap 52, actually, but 121.9 on the last lap. He's got around Johnny Molan for the fifth spot. He is closing in, only 22 seconds out of the lead.
And looking a little bit further down the order, our defending series champions, Townsend Bell and Bill Sweetler, currently run 10th in the GT Daytona class. And Justin, I think you've got Bill.
So Bill, we were just talking earlier, you know, it's definitely been a tough year for you. Twice in 3 years, you've had the team go away from underneath you. But you and Townsend, you have this great bond, this great sort of joie de vivre between the two of you. It's about you love racing so much, but it's tough out there right now, isn't it, in this car?
We are scraping the bottom of the barrel right now, I got to tell you. But, you know, this is Townsend's home track. It's great being out here. I love being out in this environment. The fans are amazing. The Robert Graham Hurricane has been running great. We've been struggling for grip, though, the entire day. So we're going to make the most of it. Next race up, Le Mans.
And of course, you're behind Robert Graham. You're behind Townsend going to Indy this year, but you can't go because it's your son's graduation.
Yeah, my son Zachary is graduating from high school. I can't miss that. He'd kill me. And, you know, it's tough, 100th running, but got to go to the graduation, Zach. I would never let you down.
That's cool. All right, keeping an eye on Townsend out there. The car's coming back underneath him, apparently. So it's done. Yeah, exactly. Wife would kill him, and it doesn't matter how wealthy you are, you still have to listen to the one in the control tower.
Absolutely true. You know what, Cal, I'm looking here, and this is, you know, we've talked about track position so often, and I think this kind of it explains its value. And you look at Farnbacher, best lap of 26.1, same for Balzan, 26.4 for Klingman, but you go back right now to the cars that are 8th, 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th, You've got a 26.4 by Spencer, a 26.5 by Bergmeister, a 26.3 by Skeen, but they're just buried and can't do anything with it.
Now on the level of competition, they're trying to get through guys like Aschenbach and Keane and Sellers. I mean, there's no easy pickings in this GTD field when you get to the second drivers.
Ooh, close right there. Klingman absolutely intent on getting around these two cars, but they're in their own battle right now. That's Lally and Skeen.
And that is for position. So our championship leaders having a really rough day. Started with that fire in the warm-up session late to the grid. Started from pit lane, had to do the drive-through. So a long, long day for Andy Lally. And with no cautions, really hard to play any strategy games to get you back at the sharp end.
Well, and that kind of leads now. Let's talk championship just a little bit here. Obviously, the lead car of Funbacher and Riberas, third in the championship, and they are 9 points adrift of Balzahn and Christina Nielsen, so they're going to make up some ground here. But those two, with Andy Lally and John Parter so far down the order, could be some pretty significant championship swings. I mean, they only came in 5 points leading.
Yeah, now it's going to be some big swings tonight. Balzahn and Christina Nielsen could lead, and Christina's been in that position. He led a lot of the championship last year, just falling a little bit shy. And two really good co-drivers along the way. Started with James Davison, Kuno Whitmer for the second part of the season. Just came up a little bit short. Just really needed to get that win late in the going. Had five podiums, but couldn't quite seal the deal.
And as we continue to watch this scrap, let's head down to JB once again, and I'll tell you, JB, Cooper McNeil drove a storming opening stint after those brake problems in qualifying.
Storming is how Greg just described your run, Cooper. He said you had a storming run. Sorry, he's so high up, it's hard for us to hear. That was a great opening stint. You must have really felt comfortable behind the wheel.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah, the car was great. The guys worked hard all night. Hats off to the WeatherTech Alex Job guys. They work hard all the time. They spent lots of hours last night making sure the car was perfect. We started on fresh tires because our qualifying didn't go as planned. We had a little mechanical issue that was fixed, and the car just ran really well for me the whole time.
So you traveled, you know, the whole of America. How important is it coming to this track? Because the fans love it, the drivers love it. What is it especially about this sort of California track?
Yeah, it's awesome. This place is fantastic. Hats off to Jill Campbell to manage such a fantastic racetrack. The fans are great. My friends are out here this weekend supporting me, so it's always good to have them here. And this place just gives us a lot of momentum if we do well here for the rest of the season. This is not an easy track, and it's really not easy to pass here either. So when you do well, you really, really deserve a pat yourself on the back kind of thing.
Great job. Now watch Lee now hopefully bring it home and have a good run to the finish. You know, when I come back, guys, I've ordered to come back as Cooper. You know that. I put down my wish list.
He has a pretty nice life and does a great job behind the wheel as well. Look at this. You can see Klingman getting a little bit annoyed and frustrated with what is essentially lap traffic because the two leaders have got through. But it was a fierce battle for position between Andy Lally and Mike Skeen that eventually went Lally's way as he completed the pass down in Rainy Curve.
But yeah, I was going to say during the interview we were watching it, he got inside the Skeen at the corkscrew. It didn't end until the approach to 10, and they never touched.
They didn't touch.
Two pros, that's how you can race.
You can do it that way. Unfortunately, some people are not patient enough to let it complete. They want to trade some paint before you get to that moment.
Here's a look at who the biggest movers are. We talked about it, that number 22 again. And as goes, this is for the lead.
This is for the lead. Renga van der Zander has caught Tom Kimber-Smith and is putting the pressure on. So they exit turn five, traffic up ahead.
Boy, Kimber's gonna try and force his way underneath Skeen. Skeen opens the door, lets him through. Van der Zander cuts hard underneath. He didn't lose much, Cal.
He did not. And then we see a car pulling off to, that's one of the Lamborghinis.
Yeah.
Might have been the car that was in pit lane earlier. But this is battle on. Renga van der Zander has come alive here in the final 6 or 7 minutes of this race.
I think we just finally saw Klingman maybe able to get around Skeen too, but boy, this is fascinating stuff.
Well, we saw it immediately after the restart, then this battle just disappeared for about an hour, and now it's back on again. Was van der Zander saving fuel? Has he now got fuel to burn? Maybe Peter Barron from Starworks has said, go get him. You're good on fuel right now.
I think that's entirely possible. I mean, we're now into the final, what, almost 6 minutes only left of this race.
And they are pushing that fuel window.
Man. And yeah, Klingman did now clear Mike Skeen, but that whole time he spent behind those two battling, I mean, he has just completely lost touch with the Freiburg-Balzahn duo.
Yeah, they just disappeared, and yeah. Farnbacher continues to lead by just over 3 seconds from Balzahn. Davison still sits in the four spot. Rob Nadel runs out the top five. But I think we're going to see a few of these guys being very tight on fuel, Greg. I've got a feeling that Laguna Seca, Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca, always throws that curveball at you. Always seems to be a fuel mileage race for some reason.
Well, you spend a lot of time fairly pinned on the throttle climbing a hill. Yeah, you get it back here when you start to run down the hill, but
really see that sand across the track, yeah, exiting the corkscrew and that sort of line that's being developed by where the cars run, separating that sand. So if you get offline, you're gonna be immediately in that. So if you push it a little bit too much, just a little bit wide, the grip level goes away from you.
Just so you know, Farnbacher, about 3 seconds he has in hand over Balzahn. But that huge margin now is blown up to almost 15 seconds. Balzahn back to Klingman. Tom Kimber-Smith still Davison. Hanging on.
Davison is coming. Yeah, here comes Colin Brown. He's in there really deep, right on the tail of Kyle Marcelli. That's going to be for the fourth position, and Simpson isn't too far down the road.
Oh, what
a driver it would be if the 54, the Core Autosport team. We said the champs have not had a great season, had a brilliant win. John Bennett, Mark Wilkins, and Colin Brown at Sebring were leading at Daytona. And Wilkins brought the car in with an engine. Right, here goes Colin Brown, slides it down to the inside.
Oh, three car pass.
Remember, he's got two more laps of fuel, as Brian Till told us, over the rest of the PC pack. Next man is his target is Steven Simpson, two-time winner this year.
That was a class move by Skeen, too. Now that he wasn't in a battle for position and those cars came up on him, he just stayed way to the side, let everybody through. As we check in on Mario Farnbacher, the 23 Team Seattle Heart of Racing entry. Donna Kitsch, that Heart of Racing concept, raising money for Seattle Children's Hospital, the cardiac team, they call it, the cardiac group.
It's a great group.
Yeah, they are.
They've really developed a wonderful relationship and chemistry between the whole core group there. Kimber Smith is Gab Van der Zander.
I think that was traffic again.
Yeah. That is critical. With only 3 minutes on the board, it takes the pressure off. There he goes.
Well, the question is when Tom Kimber Smith catches Farnbacher. Looks like he might be timing it to try and get him. I don't think he's close enough to get him into the corkscrew.
No, it's probably going to be coming down the hill at some point, maybe through Rainey. It's going to be close to him. It'll be critical if he can clear him. I think if he can clear him here, which he does, could be game over other than fuel mileage being any concern. He's got a nice gap now, and Renger van der Zander still sitting in the second position.
There's Renger. That's the margin. Ooh. He is throwing it around this racetrack.
He gives it 1,000,000%. The Dutchman is an amazing driver. Spent some time in the DTM Championship, which is really one of the premier tin top categories in the whole world. Just the level of competition over there is simply phenomenal with all of the big German manufacturers involved, from BMW, Mercedes.
And Ringer through now. As you said, Cal, that's a lot of ground to make up without some help.
It really is. Be this lap plus one more, so he's got about a lap and a half to try and do something with this. Kimber Smith just showing tremendous poise and experience that you would expect from a three-time Le Mans class winner. Talking to Bobby Ogle in the offseason, he said, I got a great group. They had great endurance help with the guys they had there. And he said, I believe that I got a stunning silver driver in Robert Alon, amazing talent. And then we all know that the job that Tom Kimber Smith can do.
Yeah, well, Robert Alon proved that correct with that run to the pole now. Will Tom Kimber be able to bring it home with the win? And in terms of that point scenario, they came in here third, so this would be huge. And with Goigberg and Simpson back in third, Van der Zander right in the middle where he started, second in the points, is the white flag. He's going to see it this time.
That battle for third is really tight between Simpson and Colin Brown.
As Molam had to bail into the pits and get fuel.
That's how tight they were. So these leaders do not have a lot of fuel on board if they're getting similar mileage to Johnny Molam. He had to duck to the pits.
There is Farnbacher. As they came across the stripe, he's been able to stretch that margin to over 4 seconds back to Balzan. So what a perfectly judged drive by both Ribiris and now Farnbacher.
Just unbelievable. The car was really superb and showed great speed through all of the practices and qualifying. On the pole by a nice margin. Ribiris took off, had the reset with the caution, but Farnbacher certainly up to the task. And this is a stunning performance by that whole group.
Is indeed sitting third in the points as they came in. This is exactly what they wanted to have happen.
Looking at timing and scoring, Colin Brown has gotten around Steven Simpson.
Oh,
he has stolen that final podium position.
There's some close quarters racing between Simpson and Marcelli, and I think, Colin Brown must have just pounced.
Yeah, that is awesome drive. I mean, talk about digging deep from potential disaster.
Here we go, last turn onto the front straight. Here comes Tom Kimber-Smith. And he will bring home the win here at Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca. Ranger van der Zande very close, only 2 seconds back in second. And in PC, Colin Brown, is he going to do third? As we watch Farnbacher flash through the Porsche, bringing it home here in front of the Ferrari of Alessandro Balzan. And Klingman looks like he should be able to bring it home in third. And what a mix we have. We've talked about it, Cal, the manufacturer mix here. That is Porsche, Ferrari, BMW, Aston Martin, Audi, Viper, Lamborghini. That is your top seven. Seven manufacturers, seven of them in the top seven.
That is awesome.
That is, I think, that's a real testament. It is to the series, to the concept of GT3. Just some phenomenal stuff. Now, while we were covering stuff at the front here, Cal, it was busy. Back a couple of spots in PC.
Wow, look at this. Marcelli and Simpson there. Simpson all locked up. Colin Brown has got through for that third position. This is for fourth in the final lap.
Yeah, look at this counter move.
Putting it all on the line. Awesome stuff.
And that at least gave Marcelli a fourth spot. Simpson ended up finishing fifth. We will be back here from our winners. Don't go anywhere. Tom Kimber-Smith emerges from that number 52 machine after a sterling drive to the win with a pole by his young teammate. And as we watch him get out of this race car, that number 52 machine, Brian Till, he's starting to work his way up the WeatherTech Series win numbers list. This is number 5.
And what a spectacular drive. And how much fuel do you really think you had when you came back in? Bobby told me he didn't even know if you were going to make it back around.
Lucky there's a big hill at the end. So, we coasted it down in neutral. It was tight. Very early on, we knew that it was going to be about fuel saving. And I had to get a bit of a gap because I knew Renger was pretty quick. So once I could get the gap and maintain it, I knew I had the race really thereabouts and maintain the fuel. But, the traffic was a big key. And, I went off a couple of times, but just managed to keep it there at the end.
Well, I think the restart was a big key, too, because it was some pretty heavy battling down there in the first corner on that restart, was it not?
Yeah, the rules are when you leave the pit box, the guy in the fast lane has the right of way, and unfortunately he just wasn't quite fast enough. So I managed to get him under the safety car prior to the rules there. And then on the restart, I just knew that I had to keep him behind me on the start. And, he gave it a good go. There was a little bit of touch in there, and, I like racing Wenger. He's a fair kid. And, you know, hopefully we can race again at the next one.
Great battle, great race. They had 2 second place finishes. Now they've got a win.
And what a win it was, no question. Let's take a look at our Audi move of the race. And Cal, it was a magnificent triple pass by Colin Brown.
Yeah, he was a man on a mission here today, having to come from the back of the pack. And he got a great run through traffic. And this is it. Coming up on some traffic, heading down towards turn five. Watch this. Gets along, Kyle Marcelli. A beautiful move.
And when we come back, we'll check in on GT Daytona. Welcome back to the Continental Tire Monterey Grand Prix, powered by Mazda. Now complete here at beautiful Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca. Here's a look at our BMW results, and you can see the win there. But I think the interesting story there, especially in terms of championship, Colin Brown and John Bennett able to come back to that third place finish. That's pretty spectacular stuff. And then Farnbacher and Ribera really controlled things today. Balzan and Nielsen did the best they could. But tell you, that was a great drive as well in that 007 Aston Martin. So as we talk about them, let's get down and meet them. Justin.
Alex, Mario, fantastic result. I'll start with you, Alex. Obviously, you're in the car first. We talked earlier, a strong run. You brought it in the lead. That was great watching him close at the end, though.
Absolutely. I mean, I worked pretty hard to create that gap with the Ferrari, and then the safety car came in, so that made life a bit harder for Mario, but he's a legend. And, you know, I hope that Tanner and Bella are watching. These two kids in the Seattle Children's Hospital. We were with them last week, and they didn't give up, so we came here and we said, you know what, we don't give up, we go for the win, and we did it.
That's perfect. They did it for the kids, they did it for the team, they did it themselves, Alex, Job, and his wife, everyone for do it for, Mario. But of course, for you, this was an important win at this point in the championship.
Oh yeah, especially after Daytona. We're closing the gap now pretty much. It's really important for this championship to make always points, and now our win is even better.
Yeah, well, congratulations to you both. Look forward to the next one. Brian?
Standing over here at Scuderia Corsa, Christina Nielsen, Alessandro Balzan. I noticed you kind of slouched down a little bit, Christina, so you were the same height here. But when you got out there, Alessandro, you're giving chase to that Porsche. At any time, did you think you had anything for the Porsche in the early going? And then what about the late going?
Well, at the beginning, I was a little bit quicker than him, so I was waiting a little bit for the tire degradation of the Porsche. But then, really, after 20 minutes, the 23 was flying. But Christina did an excellent job, the team also. The car, I was really happy with the handling of the car. So today, they were quicker. So we are happy with the second place here for Scuderia Corsa home racetrack. So it's good. Good result.
Well, it's all about the championship, isn't it, Christina? When you look at it, you know that you collect the points along the way. You needed to collect one more last year, but you guys are on a roll this year.
Yeah, you know, it's still early in the season, but I believe that we just took the lead in the championship today. That's the goal, just always getting points for the championship. But podiums are always nice, and especially victories.
Podiums are certainly nice. They'll be drinking some champagne tonight as well.
Oh, absolutely. And again, they finished in terms of that championship with the problems for the Magnus team. I mean, that was always huge for them. But boy, I'll tell you, for Team Seattle, eighth, fourth win here, pretty special stuff.
Yeah, it really was. It was a great day for that whole group. And it's all about the big picture, the championship. Christina Nielsen did a beautiful job there in the opening stint, holding down a very strong second. Balzan's a really able teammate. They're going to do wonderful things this year with that new 488. Has a lot of pace. But I tell you what, that driver pairing, Farnbacher and Ribera, they may be tough to beat for the championship.
No question there. You take a look at our Continental Tire race recap. Again, class leaders at the end, Tom Kimber-Smith and Mario Farnbacher. One caution for five laps, four lead changes in the overall order, and everybody finished. There were cars with some issues, obviously, but everybody ultimately did take the checkered flag. About a month break now, and the next time these guys race, it's back on a street circuit from Mazda Raceway to Motown.
Yeah, very different dynamic in terms of we went from the streets of Long Beach where the PCs ran, of course, GTDs didn't, to the open sweeps and the momentum of this racetrack, then back to a 100-minute sprint again. It should be a one-stop, but there's going to be strategy. You got to keep it clean. Championship on the line. Lot to talk about that weekend. It's going to be a lot of fun.
All right, and a compressed points, certainly in GT Daytona. Well, both classes, actually. What a day of racing. Two 2-hour races. It's been fascinating. Thanks so much for joining us. We look forward to bringing you the action from Detroit For Cal, for Justin, and for Brian, I'm Greg Creamer. Thanks so much for joining us here at Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca. We'll see you from Motown, and until then, take care, everybody.